last Sunday, and that I encouraged everybody, told you about, and we had in your bulletins the reading plan for the year and that, and such a positive response. I'm so thankful for that. And some of you this morning said, hey, I've already misplaced mine, or where can I get another copy? So we have these on the welcome table back there if you want to pick one up, if you haven't already done so with that. And don't worry about what you missed. Don't worry about, like, you got to take and work at it, you know, to get caught up. You know, again, just start with today's date. Because if you were here last week, we said the most important thing is we want to be full of wisdom to guide, lead, and direct us into 2017. And the greatest place that you get that wisdom is in God's Word. And just start reading God's Word, you know, and getting into God's Word and that. And so excited about that. Last Sunday, you know, it was an awesome way to start off the year. Between the two services, we had over 100 people come forward saying, as the challenge that I gave everybody, and said, you know what, let's get on the chariot. God says, just get on the chariot and I'll help you finish the race. And we said, we want to get on that chariot, do what God wants us to do, you know, through whatever that is in 2017, that we'll make a commitment that whatever God wants us to do, we'll get on that chariot. And we know then that the love and the mercy and the grace and all that of God will help us stay on that chariot and everything. And it was just a powerful, powerful way to start out the year, definitely, with it. It was the way that started off. I thought it was a good way to send off our college, the college young men and women and everything. They were heading down to Passion, which they went and they spent the week at Passion down there. And it was a neat thing, and neat to hear how God just continued that theme and continued to challenge them in that. And they're going to take some time this morning and share how God spoke to them and how God, what they learned and when it comes to that aspect with it. We're going to watch a video here real quick, like, and then Andrea is going to come up and she's going to kick it off and start talking with him. So watch this video of kind of what their 2 to 3, 4 or 5 days were like.
My refuge, my hiding place. You got, you're mine. Yes, you are. My redeemer. We're not done yet.
You're my hope in the shadows, my strength in the battle, my anchor for all my days.
Yes, you are.
You stand by my side and you stood in my place. Jesus, no other name.
Oh, only
Jesus, no other name.
Bear with me for two reasons. The first is that the 70 degree to 0 degree difference is messing with my respiratory system, and I'm sure you really feel sorry for me about that. But the second is this is not my thing. That might be surprising because I'm up here all the time with a mic singing, but that's the safety of somebody else's words. This is vulnerable. This is me up here trying to show you my heart. So please join together with me as we pray so that our message can come across. Dear Lord, please be with us and all the kids that came to Passion as we try to, in this very short time, give a message to the congregation, give them a piece of what we learned in the 12 hours of preaching and song and worship. Please let our message get across. It's in your name I pray, amen. Going first, I figured that maybe my job should be to tell you what Passion is. To you, Passion is the chili cook-off. It's the really goofy videos that start after Halloween that gives you just a small piece of the personality of the kids that went with us. Passion is a group of speakers. Passion is John Piper. Passion is Louis Giglio, Christine Kane, some of the biggest speakers in the world that speak on Jesus's message. Passion is a group of artists. Hillsong, probably the biggest worship band in the world right now. It is, gosh, my mind just went blank, Passion Band, David Crowder, Carrie Underwood even showed up. But as I switch over, I want to tell you that's not what Passion is. Passion is not a concert. Passion is not us going and excited to see these people talk. They're just people, like you and I. That's not why we're there. As awesome as the music is, watching these great artists is not why we're there. It's to see what happens through them and to see what's happening through the Holy Spirit through them to teach us a message. Last summer, I went with my mom. I took her to see Max Lucado, her favorite Christian speaker. And she also loves books, so we stopped at a bookstore in Chicago, and I found this book by Louis Giglio called The Air I Breathe, and it's about worship. It sat on my shelf from June until a week ago. I believe in coincidences is sometimes just that, it happens. But somehow last week this ended up in my bag to go to Passion. And I started to read it on the way up there. And this book is about worship. And on the back it says, everybody worships something. What captures your time and your attention? If it's Hillsong, you didn't go for the right reasons. If the highlight of that trip was Carrie Underwood jumping up there with David Crowder, you didn't get the message. If you were there to worship Jesus through them, then you got it. Louis Giglio defines worship in his book as our response, both personal and corporate, to God for who he is and what he has done, expressed in and by the things we say and the way we live. And that's what Passion was. Passion was getting to hear the messages. Passion was getting to worship with upwards of 60,000 other people that were all praising Jesus at the same time. That was powerful. But now it's time to go into life, because worship is not just singing along up here. as beautiful as Lydia's voice is, and as much as we enjoy singing, worship is not standing up and singing the songs. Worship is your heart. Worship is done every day, all day. Worship is done through our actions. Worship is praising Jesus all day long, every day.
I guess I'm first. One, I'm say thank you for letting us go to Passion and giving us your time and prayers. And through Passion, I thought it was really cool the first night when Kristen King was the first speaker. Like seeing the connections between sermons that we've had here. And like Dave's sermon that you came to before we went off, like staying in your lane, that was part of her sermon. And then back when Trey preached, if you listened, passing baton on in just every stage of life, that's what she's leading up to. The focus is all in God. So, and David Cowdy is pretty good at connecting with all the songs. So.
Well, God is always faithful, and we thank all of you for supporting us and helping us raise money. He always provides every year, and he shows up in huge ways when we get to Atlanta. This year, I find myself having to rely on God a lot for just peace and comfort, because just like entertaining my mind with other distractions and just other thoughts of other things, worrying about things. And it wasn't until like I went to God with those worries and those just distractions that I was able to find peace in his presence and just like feel his presence and give him the praise that he deserves. Being in a stadium full of 55,000 youth, like college age youth, is so beautiful. Like I found myself so many times just looking around and like being in awe of like, wow, like we're all here for the same reason, worshiping Jesus the way he deserves, and it was just really cool to get captured by just that sight of everyone worshiping. I'm going to talk more about the last sermon we had. Levi Lusco did a sermon this year. Last year he did an interview with Louis Giglio, and he wrote the book Through the Eyes of a Lion, and the book is about his daughter death and how just like going through that experience and suffering through that, but also like staying faithful and like putting his trust and his hope in Jesus. But this year he like gave an actual sermon, and so some of the highlights that really stuck out to me were that we are meant to be the fragrance of Christ to the world. He gave the analogy that in order for like perfumes to be made, something precious has to be crushed, which is what Jesus did for us and is what we have to do for Jesus in our sufferings. We need to suffer well and show the world that we have an eternal hope, and our strength comes from God and not worldly things. He also talked about how God's favorite math is multiplication, but first there must be breaking. So basically what that meant is in order to multiply or make disciples for his kingdom, we must first suffer in order for God to use our brokenness for his glory. So no matter what you're suffering, God can use your story to help others and to use your story to a story of endurance to bring people to him and to multiply. The thing that Levi mentioned that I hope and want to apply to my life specifically is that ministry must start at home. Being the only member of my family who is actively pursuing a relationship with the Lord, I want to be more open about my relationship with Christ, with my parents and my sister, or at least have a better willingness and attitude to serve at home. So I just want to take everything that I learned and just bring it home and make others know that my heart is changed. Okay. Oh. Tyler's put up with me for a week, so. Okay, so I kind of wrote some things down, so that's why I'm looking at this. But so passion has been a part of my life for 4 years. Looking back, that's crazy to think that this year was our fourth year going. Like, it doesn't seem like it, just because God has taught us something new every time, I think. But to say that passion has changed my life, or really God working through passion and using his hand through that to change the way my life is quite an understatement. I'm not going to go through like my whole story or whatever, but the first year I went to Passion, I just moved back home from going away to school, and I was in a really hard place of like determining what God was wanting to do through me. And now I'm at Bradley in Peoria, and I feel like it's where God has really placed me. And so I feel like through Passion, God has done a lot with showing his will and trusting his will. One big thing about Passion that isn't even going to the conferences, but God has taught me a lot through, has been fundraising. Like Taylor said, it's really stretched me a lot. I never knew how hard it would be and how much work it would be. But just God's faithfulness through it, and seeing you guys all as like willing vessels to be so generous and to support us in all these ways, and it's really been a great experience to trust God more and know that he is going to provide, regardless how much I stress or don't stress. Another thing that I've really learned from Passion, which is this like compiled over multiple years, I don't really know what sermon in particular really, but there's been a few sermons of like Christine Kane and Carl Lentz, and they are talking about being faithful to God where you're like where you're put at right now. And so in 1 Samuel, there's this story about David when he's a young man and he's appointed as king. And so his dad, I don't know how to pronounce his name, but his dad, the prophet comes and he's looking for the king, and the dad brings out all of his sons except David, and David's out in the field and working in the fields, and that's when he's appointed as king. And so that's been a really big focus for my life, and I think there's this common misconception that, at least as college students, we tend to think, oh, like, God will use me once I'm, like, graduated, once I have a job. But it's really important to be really faithful to God where you're at. Like, God doesn't call us to be qualified before we start working for him and furthering his kingdom. He doesn't want perfection. He wants us to be faithful where we are and to be his servants. And it's not just, oh, okay, once I get to this point, then I'll be able to be his servant. It's like, no, God wants you where you're at right now. And there's multiple like instances of that in the Bible of the disciples being fishermen, and he's like, okay, like, come right now. Like, you're not in some prominent position, but he wants us. So that's been just really life-changing, because it's affected the way I live my life every day rather than waiting for some future date. Okay, and then one more thing. This year, another big thing that Passion has done for me, which isn't always the most comforting thing, but has been conviction of sin. This year, John Piper preached on the essence of evil, which isn't exactly like, oh yeah, that's so exciting, like, let's hear more about evil. But he was talking about like sin in our lives, and he said that evil is not just actions. Like, sinning is not just our actions or the evil behind it, but it is to prefer anything more than God, or even, he said, to lose a taste for God. And one of the other things he said that really stuck with me is, like, if I just live to do good enough, I minimize the triumph of Christ on the cross, dumb down the majesty of God, and gut the glory of a Christian life pleasing to God. And that really hit me, because it's like, because it's, when I think of being bad or not following God, it's, oh, like, this is the sin I did, this, I lied here. But it's way more than that. It's not, is not the action, but it's the heart behind it is the essence of evil, and it's so convicting. Even little things like social media or something, it's like, how many days, or when have I woken up and checked social media before I prayed? Or when have I put something ahead of God and lost the taste for God? And just to be willing and convicted of that, and to hate that essence of sin, and how often that I grow complacent with putting things in the place that God has in my life. And so that's really just show me that the Christian life is more than just doing good things or trying to be good enough, but it's the pursuit of God, my entire heart and my entire life. Your turn.
So, I've been to Passion for all 4 years, and there are certain things that I've definitely really enjoyed, which is, you know, the sermons and the sessions and the music, and some things I don't necessarily enjoy, which is the crowds of people. But, so there's something that I think I've been noticing all along, but didn't really click in me until this year, is just an undercurrent of everyone serving for one goal. And it could be, you know, like big stuff, like the worship leaders and all the different bands doing, you know, great jobs, because like they go in the morning throughout the entire day, and then like they get up again the next day, and that's insane. But like, and then there's the door holders, who I apparently heard Louis say there's like a couple thousand of them. I'm like, I just thought they were people telling us where to go. But, and then also just even the smaller things amongst the people that went, like, even the most stressful times where, say, everyone needs to go to the bathroom, and letting a person that has, like, a physical disability go first. Like, it's all about serving for one goal. And I finally figured that out this year. So, take us home, Scott.
Man, those students are great, aren't they? So impressive to hear their hearts. I've been with them in youth group, high school youth group, and just to see them and how far they've come, I mean, they are head and shoulders above where I was at their age. I don't want to sound old, but it's time to face the music. I'm just lucky to be hanging on their shirt tail through all this. They invited me the second year they went, to be, you know, a mature adult that went along and kept them safe and guided them and made all the hard decisions. So that's why we had Andrea go and Anita's gone. They tricked me. They're like, you're the mature adult. And I'm like, yeah, right. But no, it's great to see them up here, and the older I get, the more I flash back, you know, to days gone by. And it's amazing. Like I said, the stuff they, even the words they use, I'm like, I didn't know that word when I was your age. Undercurrent, seriously? But I am just blessed to be a part of it, and we are blessed as a group for your support. It's amazing. In some people's eyes, we might be a small church, but we have done some great things. You know, we've gone all around the United States, you know, Boston, and we're going to Mexico, and to be able to go to Atlanta and experience something like this is really a chance of a lifetime, and I've got to do it three times, so that's three lifetimes. Passion, for me, I've not really known what passion was. You know, you kind of go and experience it. you know, it's geared towards 18 to 25 year olds, they say, you know, the college age. But last year they kind of marketed it as 18 to 25 year olds and their leaders. So, you know, I didn't feel necessarily like left out when I went, you know, because I'm not just the crazy old guy in the corner. But the thing about passion is it's just so evident that it's the Spirit of God moving through 18 to 25 year olds, in the millennials, they call them. These kids who are, I say kids and I don't mean kids, but these young adults, these burgeoning people, a lot of times the millennials get a hard knock or whatever. They're, you know, they don't get credit for knowing what's going on or where they're going or what they want or having any desire to know God. But to be in Atlanta and experience, you know, 50 to whatever it was, 60,000 people, you know, 18 to 25 year olds, they're united to seek God and to worship Him, kind of sheds a different light. It gives you hope, gives me hope, you know. In years past, they released the worship music, you know, weeks ahead of time, so you can learn the worship songs and get familiar with them. It's always, I'm one of those people who likes to know what they're singing before they sing it, otherwise they just stand there and, you know. But this year, they didn't release the new songs before, and so the amazing thing was is watching this stadium full of people pick up on this new worship song, like this second time, third time we've heard it, and people are singing their hearts out. You know, they're running down to the stage front so they can jump and sing and worship to this song, and it's just amazing to see how quickly, you know, something can pick up, or, you know, how something can catch on. And it's you know, it's not so much a catchy song as it is the pure, just instant worship that happens. The Spirit of God is I believe is truly on the Passion movement. I don't know if it is a movement or if it's an organization or what it is, but for sure it's amazing. And I'm lucky to be a part of it. And it's you kind of, you know, you get familiar with the slow down. You get familiar with the speakers after a while. I mean, you know, like Francis Chan, Louis Giglio, in the worship, David Crowder, Hillsong. You kind of know what to expect on one hand. But on the other hand, I mean, you know God is going to show up. You know you're climbing up the mountain, and God's going to speak to you and speak to you deeply. But you don't know where. And a lot of times, you know, at least me personally, I think, oh, you know, I'm going to get a lot out of Francis Chan. But God usually ends up speaking to me just through ways I'm not expecting. And this year, personally, I went with the expectation of having no expectations, you know, not hedging God in and thinking, oh, he's going to speak to me through Francis Chan. He's not going to speak to me through Levi Lesko because he's not a good preacher. It wasn't the case. Levi Lesko is a great preacher. But God shows up in amazing ways. Like Tyler was saying, it's about how, you know, it's all about one thing, whether you're going to the bathroom or, you know, singing worship. But before a couple of the sessions, I really became somber and introspective. And a few of them picked up on it, like, you okay? You know, are you having fun? You ready? You know, I'm like, yeah, I'm fine. But, you know, inside I was kind of watching them and watching the others, and I just became heavy-hearted. Because, you know, passion is great and it's a mountaintop experience, but life off the mountain is hard. And being old and facing the music as I am, you know, the older I get, not to be silly, but the more my heart breaks for them because, you know, in one sense, you know, I know what's ahead. I don't know what's going on, where they're going to be, how they're going to end up, but I know life is hard. Life off the mountain is hard. And raising two daughters of my own, on my own, no, just kidding. I find myself praying, what do you call that? Proactively, trying to show you up, Tyler. But I find myself just, you know, worried for their future. Like I said, they're head and shoulders where I was at this age, and the things they're dealing with and they're accepting and they're experiencing with passion and here at church are just amazing. My heart was breaking and heavy for them, and I wasn't sure why, because it wasn't like I wasn't burdened for them or didn't want to, you know, like, I'm like, God, you know, I'm already burdened to help them or and to be with them alongside them and do life together. So, like Taylor was talking about, Levi Lesko talking about, the aroma of Christ. The thing about life being off the mountain hard, if that makes sense, and sooner or later life crushes you. And that doesn't necessarily mean like, you know, physically or majorly. That could be, you know, emotionally, relationally, because of work, school, it could be your confidence, and so on. But I mean, if we're honest, life is crushing at times, and it gets the best of us. And there's no amount of conferences or college courses or Dave Beal sermons that can prevent that from happening. So it didn't really make sense to me until the last session, which was Levi Lesko. But you know, like I said, I wonder why God was laying this on my heart. We're moments away from you know, reaching fever pitches in worship and hearing some of the greatest sermons, and I was somber and introspective, which is, if you know me, that's just not my, that's usually not the way I present myself. Levi Lesko talked about how recently his wife had gotten into the essential oils. I don't know if you're familiar with that at all. You know, they're scents for everything, to help you sleep, to take away stress, to get rid of headaches. Our hotel room even had sample packs of essential oils in their little folder thing. And I was like, wow, I can't get away from this. You know, it's not uncommon to come home and experience a new scent, and I'm like, I don't know if the house is on fire or what. And my wife's like, no, that's just me. But here's where it started to make sense. Like Levi Lesko pointed out, most everything that, like in these essential oils, that makes a smell, doesn't do so without being crushed. And the amazing thing about that is that in 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 15, it says, we are to God the pleasing aroma of Christ among those who are being saved and perishing, or who are perishing. The amazing thing is that, you know, I started questioning, he presented to us, you know, can we be the aroma of Christ without first being crushed? We're all going to get crushed, whether you're in Christ or not. But, so the question is not whether you're going to get crushed, but what kind of fragrance are you going to be when you do get crushed? Beth Moore said, at any given point in our Christian walk, we are deciding what Jesus is worthy of. Is he worthy of our hope? Is he worthy of our confidence? Is he worthy of our faithfulness? Is he worthy of us turning from our favorite sin? Is he worthy of us persevering? At any given point, we're deciding that. Francis Chan preached on Ephesians chapter 1, verse 18, which talks about how we are God's inheritance. Often we read about all we inherit in Christ, but it's kind of it was refreshing to think about that we are God's inheritance in Christ. We're God's reward, so to speak, you know. all the cross and everything is ends up being, you know, we end up being God's reward. So we're his inheritance. And that's a pretty big deal. So I just want to challenge you in closing is Christ worthy of you putting your life in him? Is he worthy of you putting those sins behind you? Is he worthy of you getting up and trying again? Is he worthy of choosing faith over sin? Is Christ worthy of us staying in the chariot when life gets hard, like Dave preached? Yeah, he's worthy of all these things and more. When we put our lives in him and life crushes us, we emit the aroma of Christ. It's that crushing that gives us the opportunity to be the fragrant aroma of Christ, or you could say the fragrant offering. So, you know, what you put your hope in, when you get crushed, that's what you're offering up. So, don't waste another day. You are God's inheritance. You are worthy of Christ, and Christ is worthy of you. Decide today you're not going to stink when life crushes you. Decide today that you are going to be the fragrant offering of Christ. Thank you.
Amen. You know, I like how Andrew came out and Andrew said, you know, to us, you know, when we think about passion, and that passion is, you know, the chili cook-off and those kinds of things. And I wanted them to share. I want them to understand because, you know, you guys give so much of time, you know, to help all the different ages, you know, go to different events and stuff. And if you've never been there, you've never experienced, it's hard to understand how God is speaking and how God can use these things in these places, these conferences, these trips and everything to really challenge, to really pour into the hearts and lives. But I loved a lot of what I was hearing today as far as the heart, you know, and as far as what God has done. And it just, again, just to me, just reaffirms and stuff that, you know, we all worship the same God as far as, I mean, not, let me back up and say that, not all gods are equal and that, but I mean, it's, I love the statement that was said as far as, you know, I think it was Dalton that brought it out, the point about, you know, you hear this here, and we, you know, I heard Trey talk about passing the baton, and then, you know, Kristen Kane gets up and talks about the baton and that, and the reason you can go to these conferences, you can go to these places, and you can hear the same thing being driven home in the same aspects, because it's the same God, and it's the same truth, you know, that we have and we need to hear and stuff like that, and and the way that God uses that, and I mean, you know, wow, what a way to start the year out for us as far as that aspect, and to be thinking about it. I mean, you know, we start our year out thinking about this chariot and how do I get on this chariot and how do I stay on this chariot, and that was the challenge, and now it's like, all right, you know, gosh, as I'm sitting here listening to him talk and stuff like that, the thing that kept thinking is, you know why it's so hard for us to get on that chariot? Because we don't allow ourselves to be crushed. You know, there's things in my life that I have to step up to get on there. You know, the whole symbolism of what we're talking about, you know, deals with, you know, surrendering and just allowing this to be crushed in my life, this whatever it is, you know. And I liked how the way it was said, you know, it's like, yeah, some of these things I like to do and I don't like to do, but it doesn't matter. I still do them. And that could be a crushing effect on our lives, you know. That's crushing pride, you know. Well, I don't want to get up and I don't want to do this and I don't want to say this. Good, because it isn't about you. So get yourself out of the way. Let God crush that selfishness and that pride that's within you. And now do what you're supposed to do. I mean, that's what it's going to take. You know, and that's what it does take, you know, and I appreciate hearing, you know, their hearts and that and how God, every single one of us in this room, you know, I God has a plan. You hear me teach it, you hear me preach it, go away to these different places and they're, you know, it's not me, it's not Louie, it's not these people, it's the Word of God. And that's what unites us, and that's why you can hear and these things. It's wonderful. And I guess as we get ready to close our time, as the worship team comes out here and we continue to sing to this God that loves us, and it does blow us away to think that, guess what, we are his reward, you know, and everything. You know, one of the neat things to do is just take some time here and think about, you know, what do I got to allow God to crush in my life? What is it that I have to allow so I can step up and get involved in the life that God wants me? Whether I like it or not, it doesn't matter. I still need to do it. You know, I still need to worship because, as Andrew said at the beginning, we will all worship something. You know, so what are we going to worship? What we want to worship, or are we going to worship God in the way that God wants us to worship? And what does that look like within our life and that? And I just want us to pray about that aspect and take a look at that and think about it. As we're in 2017 now, we're coming up already a couple weeks into 2017. You know, maybe all of you, your New Year's resolutions, maybe they've all failed, you know, and you had these great starts, or maybe you're still going strong with it. Well, I don't know where it is with it, but I know one thing that never, ever has failed us, and that is God and who he is and what he wants for us and what he wants to do within our lives. So I want us to take some time and pray and as always, each and every week, allow God's Spirit, you know, to look into your hearts. What are the things that you're holding on to that God says, sorry, you know? Sometimes the world will crush us, but honestly, sometimes God does it. And sometimes God allows those things to come into our life to crush us, so we'll focus where we need to focus, and that's on him. But he's always, always there. And I don't know what's going on in your life. I don't know how you've been crushed. I don't know how God will crush us. I don't know what God wants to get out of our way for 2017 so we can be used by him and we can be used for him and all those kinds of things. But I want us to spend time in prayer. And then if you know, if you're sitting there going, yeah, I need prayer to get this out of the way. I need prayer for this, or I need prayer so I can get on that chariot, or whatever that is. Then while we're singing this song to this God that loves us and wants to be there and everything and lifting it up and worshiping that way, come on up. I'll be up front here with us. And you know, we can celebrate life. So we can celebrate, you know, this year. We can celebrate this God that loves us so much. Let's pray. Father, I thank you. I thank you for all the opportunities that you give us to hear, to understand, to learn, to grow, to be crushed. Heavenly Father, I thank you for what that means. And I thank you for these lives that went down and spent this time in Atlanta and the way that you poured into them. I know more, Father God, than right now they can even comprehend. And I pray that your Holy Spirit will continue to work on their hearts. Father God, sometimes as we've said it before, and I've heard other people that got on these trips, it's kind of like trying to drink from a fire hydrant, all the information that's just given to you, all the great messages and everything. So I pray, Father God, that you will continue to, Father, just recall to their minds what they need for their lives. And I thank you for these moments that they shared with us, and help us to remember that, you know, we got to stop and we got to look. We're going to worship something. What are we going to worship? And Father God, worshiping you isn't easy, and there's things you ask us to do we don't want to do, but that's okay. We still do them because you love us. And I pray, Father, that your Holy Spirit will look into our lives, will search into our hearts and see where are those areas that we need to surrender, those areas that we've heard this morning that need to be crushed, Heavenly Father, so we can get ourselves out of the way and it be nothing but serving you and living for you, Father. Show us that, Father God. And if we just need to come before our family and say, please pray, because I need this. Please pray because I need you. Father, I just pray that wisdom just fill us, that strength just fill us to allow that to happen today, Father. Thank you again for this day that you have made that we could gather and sing and gather around the table and remember, gather and take up, Father God, and just give back to you, Father, what was yours and just the blessings upon blessings you have for us, Father. Now just hear our hearts as we sing out to you. In Christ's name, we pray. Amen. Please stand.